Our call to worship this morning comes from Psalm 105, verses 1 through 3. O God, O give thanks to the Lord, call upon his name, make known his deeds among the peoples. Sing to him, sing praises to him, tell of all his wondrous works. Glory in his holy name. Let the hearts of those who seek the Lord rejoice. Today, it is my prayer that that you would have this opportunity to rejoice in the Lord and what he has done for us. Amen? Let's sing together.
If you don't get off that Xbox, I will make sure you never play it again.
Listen, if you don't settle down and go to bed, you can sleep outside tonight.
Little girls who aren't grateful don't get any presents at Christmas.
Any of these clothes that are still on the floor in 10 minutes are going to be given to someone who really needs them.
You come home late one more time, you won't have a car.
Stop fighting or I'm turning this car around right now.
Happy Father's Day.
So for Father's Day, we get to kick it back to father of everybody, Adam, and some of his problems. So scripture reading today, we'll be starting Genesis 3, right at the beginning of the Bible. Starting with verse 1. Now the serpent was more crafty than any other beast of the field that the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, "Did God actually say you shall not eat of any tree in the garden?" And the woman said to the serpent, "We may eat of the fruit of the trees in the garden, but God said, 'You shall not eat of the fruit of the tree that is in the midst of the garden, neither shall you touch it, lest you die.'" But the serpent said to the woman, You will not surely die. "For God knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will be opened and you will be like God, knowing good and evil." So when the woman saw that the tree was good for food and that it was a delight to the eyes and that the tree was to be desired to make one wise, she took of its fruit and ate. And she also gave some to her husband who was with her, and he ate. Then the eyes of both were opened and they knew that they were naked. And they sewed fig leaves together and made for themselves loincloths. And they heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day. And the man and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God among the trees of the garden. But the Lord God called to the man and said to him, "Where are you?" And he said, "I heard the sound of you in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, and I hid myself." He said, "Who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten of the tree of which I commanded you not to eat?" The man said, "The woman who you gave me to be with, she gave me the fruit of the tree, and I ate." And the Lord God said to the woman, "What is this that you've done?" The woman said, "The serpent deceived me, and I ate."
Our second Bible reading comes from Mark 15, starting in verse 33, reading in Jesus' name, because it's God's word, not mine. "And when the sixth hour had come, there was darkness over the whole land until the ninth hour. And at the ninth hour, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, 'Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani,' which means, 'My God, why have you forsaken me?' Some of the bystanders, hearing it, said, 'Behold, he's calling Elijah.' And some ran and filled a sponge with sour wine and put it on a reed and gave it to him to drink, saying, 'Wait, let's see whether Elijah will come to take him down.' And Jesus uttered a loud cry and breathed his last. And the curtain of the temple was torn in two, from the top to the bottom. And when the centurion who stood facing him saw that in this way he had breathed his last, he said, 'Truly, this man was the Son of God.'" We're in Romans 5 today. In Romans 5, Jesus, through Paul, talks to us about sin entering the world through one man and being passed on to everyone through one man, Adam. That's what you read about. But our hope is in the other one man, Jesus, the one who died on a cross to take all that sin away. Truly, he is the Son of God. We are continuing our I've been saying walk through the book of Romans, but that's not entirely accurate. I mean, when you're taking a chapter of Romans a week, it's not really a walk. It's more like a nice steady jog, you know, something along those lines. It's a little quicker maybe than what we'd prefer, but we are, you know, kind of digging into Romans. If you're saying to yourself, "I need a little more Romans," don't sweat it. Come out on Thursdays and you get like a whole lot of Romans. And then by Sunday, you know, we've kind of tightened things up just a little bit. And as we dig into Romans chapter 5 on Father's Day, I saw this conversation between a father and a son play out. Romans 5, kind of the first part that we're going to deal with is bookended by peace. And if there's anybody who needs to hear about peace, it's us, because we are prone to conflict. The reason why we're so prone to conflict is because sin just creates conflict. I watched this scene play out, this conversation between a father and his son, both adults at this time. I wasn't here, one of my previous churches. Richard's son had been away from the church for quite some time. And he was kind of doing his own thing, but still professed faith in God, but that was not good enough for Richard. And so I got to overhear this conversation. Richard said to his son, "If you'll just clean up your life, fix up a couple of these things, stop drinking so much, stop smoking, and buy a decent pair of pants, then you can come back to church and God will forgive you. Yeah. That's wrong. That's wrong. I was heartbroken. See, Richard, I have no doubt that he loves his son. But his theology, it sure didn't come from Romans. I don't know where it came from, but this idea that if someone will just clean up their lives, then they can come back, and then God will forgive them, and then God will save them. It's not right, and yet I've heard it over and over and over again, not just from Richard, and we say these things, you know, it can happen in some very subtle ways in which we say, hey, son, hey, daughter, hey, sister, hey, husband, hey, wife, if you'll just change, then I'll forgive you. God will forgive you. Let's check out Romans and see what God says about this. Because there is a perfect timing. The perfect timing for us to be saved is not after we've cleaned up our life and come back to church. No, 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 no. The perfect timing, as we're going to hear in Romans, is when we're weak, helpless, when we're ungodly, when we're sinners, when we're enemies with God. That's the perfect timing. That is the perfect time for God to save us. If you have your Bibles, you can turn with me to Romans. If not, it's going to be right here. Romans chapter 5, reading in Jesus' name. And I originally thought that I was going to, you know, try and tackle the entire chapter. So funny. Ain't no way I'm getting through all of Romans 5 in just a couple of minutes. So unless you are saying to yourself, hey, Jay, don't worry, we'll postpone the Father's Day, you know, barbecue so that you can spend the next 3 hours going through Romans chapter 5, which, you know, would then make Joshua and I late for camp today. We don't want to do that. So I'm just going to tackle Romans 5, 1 through 11, reading in Jesus' name because it's God's word, not mine. Therefore, since we have been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Through him, we have also obtained access by faith into this grace in which we stand. And we rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. Not only that, but we rejoice in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character does not produce, you know, produces hope, and hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. For while we were still weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. For one will scarcely die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person one would dare even to die. But God shows his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Since therefore we have been justified by his blood, much more shall we be saved by him from the wrath of God. For if while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his son, how much more, now that we are reconciled, shall we be saved by his life? More than that, we also rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation. Here ends the reading of God's word. And so we have it. We have peace at the beginning because we have been justified by faith. And that's what we talked about last week. We talked all about being justified by faith, that God looks at in Christ Jesus because of what Christ Jesus did for us on the cross. God looks at each and every one of us justified, never sinned. Not because of what we've done, but because of what he's done for us. And we receive that by grace through faith. And that gives us peace. Not like peace, like, oh, yeah, man. No. I'm talking peace like the absence of conflict. You see, the kind of reconciliation and peace that we have is a gift from God, because without Christ and without what he has done for us, we're just fighting with God all the time. Now, it's not always like that loud fighting that you get at home. I mean, not your home, other people's homes. Other people's homes where they, you know, like do that thing where they yell at each other and stuff like that. I'm not going to say anything to Jerry because he's my neighbor. So just in case one of those other homes is over to the side, you know, just not going to say anything to Jerry. I'm just saying that what happens within households is that people fight. People yell, people argue, people get angry, and there is conflict because we're all a bunch of selfish little sinners. And that conflict between people pales in comparison to the conflict that happens with God. And the conflict in our homes isn't always the loud, yelly kind. Sometimes it's the quiet, pouty kind. What's wrong? Nothing. Just seems like something's wrong. No. You seem like you might be a little upset. Again, I'm sure the quiet, pouty kind of conflict doesn't happen in your house. It happens in other people's houses. Loud conflict, other people's. That's the thing, is we have this exact same types of conflict with the Lord. Sometimes our quiet conflict with the Lord is kind of like, I do not believe you did that. God, I'm not saying anything, I'm just saying. Maybe you've had some loud conflict with the Lord. I had some loud conflict with the Lord while I was driving across the country when I was 18 years old. I was somewhere in the desert between Las Vegas and California. And in my folly and in my sin, I yelled at the Lord for an extended period of time. I'm not entirely sure how long. I do know that it was quite dry, that my car was overheating, and I was wearing a cold, wet t-shirt that I would switch out with one in my cooler because I had to keep the heat on in my car while driving through the desert at 100 plus degrees just to keep the engine temperature a little bit lower. So, overheating car, heat on in the car, driving through the desert, overheating Jay, yelling at God. I'm not entirely sure how long it lasted. It was loud, I can only assume, because I lost my voice. And at the point in which I lost my voice after some number of hours of yelling, I almost heard God say, "Ah, you're done. Thank you." How do we receive peace from this conflict with God, and how does that move us into peace in our conflict with each other? If you're anything like me, I need that peace. You need that peace. Your households need that peace. Your relationship with the Lord needs that peace. Where's that peace come from? We have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Through him, we have also obtained access into this grace in which we stand. When we were talking about standing before God a couple of weeks ago, this is what he's talking about, that we stand before God in grace. We're just standing in grace, that is what holds us. And when we fall into grace too. This grace in which we stand, and we rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. That's the kind of rejoicing that I like. Rejoicing in the hope of the glory of God. You see, if we're followers of Jesus Christ, if we are believers in his name, then we're rejoicing in this hope that one day we get to go to glory with God. That's going to be awesome. And part of the reason for this hope is that that means this isn't all there is. That there's more, that God has something in store for each and every one of us. And he desires that everyone would be saved, that everyone would believe in him and receive this gift of salvation. He wants us all there. And so it's available for everyone by grace, through faith, everyone who believes. That's the kind of rejoicing I like. It's the next part of rejoicing that I'm like, Paul, you lost me. Not only that, but we rejoice in our sufferings. I'm sorry. Try and read that one again. Maybe it said something different in the Greek. Nope, that's what it says. Not only that, but we rejoice in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. And hope does not put us to shame because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. This isn't the type of rejoicing that says, "Woo! I love suffering!" It's not that kind of rejoicing. It's joy in the knowledge that our suffering isn't meaningless. If we're going through an experience and that's creating suffering in our lives, but it's hard, but we know that God is using it for a purpose, that produces some rejoicing. There's a guy in my neighborhood, affectionately referred to as Running Guy by me. I love giving people nicknames. So if you hang out in my neighborhood, or maybe if you just hang out around me, you may receive a nickname. You may not know that that's your nickname because Running Guy has no idea that that's his nickname. Running Guy started running about a year ago, and when he started running in our neighborhood, he could not run very far. I totally understand. Running looks like suffering to me. And so he would run and then he'd walk and he'd run and walk. And I'm like, that looks good. I mean, if you have to run, that seems like an okay way to do it. Run, walk, run, walk, run, walk, run, walk. And he'd do that one lap around up near our neighborhood. It's approximately a mile if you do the extra little cul-de-sac. He ran every day. He's been running every day. Crazy polar vortex, he was running. Crazy floody rain, he's running. Crazy insane snowstorm, Running Guy is running. It started with run, walk, run, walk, run, walk. Then it grew to running one full lap around. Yesterday, ran four laps. He was not wearing his stretched out beanie, okay? Because like for months he's been wearing this beanie over top of his like massive headphones. A few of us have also heard him having some extremely loud conversation with who's ever on the other end of those headphones, but he has no idea what's going on. So he's just yelling as he's running through the neighborhood. It's a little bit scary. I know there was suffering involved because I see the look on his face. I know there was suffering involved because I see him suffering and I'm like, better you than me, buddy. But what I've also seen is that suffering has produced endurance. And little bit by little bit, he's gone from run, walk, run, walk, run, walk, to run, 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 to run a lap, and run a lap, and run a lap, and run mile one, and run mile two, and run mile three, and run mile four. The other thing I notice, he's yelling on his phone less. I think in the beginning, he was just mad to be out there. He yelled a lot on his phone in the beginning. He's not yelling as much. He's just running. Now, I don't know if that's because he's trying to continue breathing, you know, or if God is developing some character with him and him, but I'm looking forward to meeting him. One of these days, I'm just going to, like, run alongside, you know. Who am I kidding? No, I'm not. That was hilarious. Maybe I'll catch him at the end of a run for his cool down when he starts walking. That's our life with Christ. That once he has given us this peace and he's solved the conflict that we have between us, it allows us to not just blame God for every little bit of suffering that comes into our lives. It allows us to see the suffering in our lives as, hey, God could use this. And that's why we can rejoice even when we're suffering, knowing that the suffering is going to produce endurance, and endurance is going to produce character, and character is going to produce hope. And the hope comes because all of a sudden we realize that the Lord God is pouring God's love into our lives, just like pouring out water and just kind of pouring it over top of us. You know, the other day, Rogi was messing with me. He snuck around the house, and he had a little squirt bottle, a little Gatorade bottle, and, you know, and he was squirting me from around the corner, and so then he got me real good, and then I decided to pour out the love of Jay into his life. And so I grabbed that water bottle, I took off the top, and I chased him and poured that water right over him. He was completely soaked in the love of Jay. Thankfully, it's Rogi, and he actually felt loved. Not everybody would. God does that in our lives. He just comes afterwards with the power of the Holy Spirit. He just pours out his love into us and just kind of soaks us into our hearts. His love. And so if we look at what's the perfect time for this to happen, verse 6. For while we were still weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. For one will scarcely die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person one would even dare to die. But God, I love those words, but God shows his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. This is the good stuff. You see, the right time for us to be saved is while we're still sinners. The right time for us to be saved is while we're weak. While we know that we have nothing to offer, we have no spiritual strength, we have no spiritual ability, we have no ability to save ourselves, we are weak. The right time is while we are ungodly. Ungodly is the right time for us to be saved? Well, yeah, because ungodly people need to be saved. That's the right timing. The right timing for us to be saved is while we're still sinners. God's not waiting for us to clean up our lives. God's not waiting for us to be good enough to save. God's not waiting for us to earn some kudos or something like that and say, oh yeah, I guess I'll save him now. No, 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 no. The right time for us to be saved is while we're weak, ungodly, sinners, still enemies of God. That's the right time. That's when Christ died for us. When we're weak, ungodly, sinful, enemies of God. That's when Christ died for us. That's when Christ reconciled us to the Lord and made us no longer enemies, but gives us peace. Removes the conflict. It transforms our lives so that we can see even suffering in a totally different way. Where are you at today? Be honest with yourself. You don't have to shout it out. Be honest with yourself. Where's your conflict? Where's your conflict? If you're not yet a believer in Christ, if you're not sure where you're at with God, where's your conflict? Your conflict is with God. And if you still have a conflict with God, I got to tell you, you're going to have conflict with each other. Where's your conflict? Are you at war with yourself? Or are you at war with the people you love? Are you at war with God? The Almighty God, through the power of His Son Jesus Christ and what Jesus has done for us, wants to give you peace, wants to reconcile that conflict and end the war. Now's the right time. While you're weak, while you're enemies, while you're selfish little sinners, now's the right time to receive the reconciliation that only Christ could do for us. Let's pray. Lord God, thank you. We couldn't do it on our own. We're weak. We couldn't save ourselves. We're weak. God, we can't stop the conflict. We're still enemies. Without you, we're stuck in our sin. And Lord, we confess that even those of us who are already believers in your name, who already know and love you, we still, it's like we put this reconciliation to the side and we put this peace to the side and still just dive into the conflict, and I have no idea why we do that. We know that the peace only comes from you. We know that you died for us at just the right time. So we ask you, Lord God, to help us to believe. Give us faith to believe that you died for us while we were still sinners. You died for us to give us peace, to remove the conflict, and transform how we see life. Transforming it from conflict to rejoicing, from war to peace in our relationship with you and in our homes and in all of our relationships. Lord, you have the power to do that by transforming us through the power of your Holy Spirit, by pouring your love into our lives. Thank you for pouring your love out. Thank you for allowing us to be baptized in your love, washed clean of all of our sin. Thank you for dying for us at just the right time. It's in your name we pray, Lord Jesus, our Savior. Amen.